I'm serious, it may seem hilarious, but something has pierced me to the heart. My life, though quite blameless, was empty and aimless, till Cupid popped up and fired his dart.
Now don't think me spiteful, I find it delightful, that beauty like mine can blight your eyes. Oh, assistance, you see, invites resistance, from me for such insistence, can take one by surprise.
Oh, don't be alarmed by me, admit that you're charmed to see a man of such enterprise. Just come. Varasdin, the sweetest place you've ever seen. That's where our destiny has plans for you and me.
Hello, my name is Sigurd Neubauer, and I'm the publisher of Man and Culture magazine. We are a lifestyle company dedicated to celebrating culture, sports, and tourism. If you like this podcast, make sure to click like and subscribe. Today, it is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Stefan Frey, a prominent scholar on the world of operetta and the biographer of Hungarian composer Emmerich Kálmán, among others. We will be discussing Kálmán's beloved operetta, Countess Maritza, which premiered in Vienna in 1924 and in New York the following year. The recording here is by the Sadler Wells Opera under the baton of Barry Wordsworth. Welcome, Dr. Frey.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
We just heard an excerpt from Let's Go to Varasdin. Tell us a little bit more about this beautiful duet and the role in popular culture.
This song is very popular in Europe and especially in Germany and Hungary, Austria, because it's Hungarian, folkloristic, and it's a shimmy. It's Kálmán tried to be modern and to use jazz rhythms as the shimmy and to combine it with his traditional Hungarian music. And yeah, it became a very popular dance song. And I think it is one of the most popular songs of Kálmán at all.
And tell us a little bit more about the jazz aspects and how that became his particular style.
Yeah, it's interesting to compare Countess Maritza with the Csárdásfürstin 9 years before, composed during World War I. And after that, yeah, themes have changed very heavily, especially for the former Austro-Hungarian Empire. Yeah, it didn't exist anymore. So people were looking for new issues, and especially the jazz was something that changed operetta at that time very much. And Kálmán made his first experiments with jazz in the Bayadia, the operetta before Countess Maritza. There he composed a shimmy, Fräulein können Sie Shimmy tanzen, and that was a big success. And I think he thought that it's a good measure to write in a new style operettas during the 20s. And you see it in works like Circus Princess and especially The Duchess of Chicago, that the jazz became more and more important for him.
And yeah, and then when we come back to Countess Maritza, as our listeners will be delighted to know, it is Kálmán's most famous and celebrated operetta here in the United States and in the English-speaking world. Tell us a little bit about its premiere in Vienna and then in New York. What was Kálmán's life like during the 1920s? You had just mentioned how he found inspiration in jazz. And how was the operetta received? And what makes this operetta unique from his other works?
Yeah, I think Kálmán had the bad luck to have his first success during World War II, so all the Allied states didn't play his works. So Countess Maritza was his first big international success. And at that time, American directors came to Vienna to look for new pieces to play, because in the first half of the 20s, also in America, operetta was a big thing. Yeah, all the great American operettas were written in that time. So the Countess Maritza fitted very good in that. And it also had this special nostalgic flair that make it interesting for American audiences. In Vienna, it was another thing, because the story which is told in Countess Maritza was very actual, Yeah, the hero is a declassed man, a noble man who lost his fortune. And this situation was very familiar to many people in the audience. And nevertheless, he gets this rich lady from Hungary. So, yeah, because he is working hard for that. And that's new for operetta, because the former heroes of operetta used to do nothing and live from their fortune. So I think that was also an interesting moment. And the other thing was that Hubert Marischka, the director of the Theater an der Wien, where the Countess Maritza was opened, he was inspired by review and by American shows and by London theater he experienced in his youth. And he followed his father-in-law, Wilhelm Karczak, who was the big man of the era before World War II. Yeah, he made successes like Merry Widow and so on. And so he had the chance now to find a new style of performing for operetta, more show-like, more glamorous, more review. And the public was very surprised by that new style. And Countess Maritza had his first big production. So different things came together, a new performance style, new kind of music of Kálmán, and the story, who was both actual and nostalgic.
So in other words, the fact that so many people had lost their wealth in the early part of the 20th century, and that this was a theme that he built on, and that people could appeal to that, and the fact that it was a new musical style, is really interesting. And it's also, you know, as you had mentioned, the music was new, but, you know, the story is also compelling, which brings us right to the writers. Can you tell us a little bit about Julius Brammer and Alfred Grünewald, the two librettists behind the operetta? And please tell us a little bit more about their artistic collaboration with Kálmán.
That's also an interesting coincidence, because Countess Maritza really is their first common work, although the Bayadere was performed earlier, but they tried to get in contact with Kálmán for years, and they succeeded with the libretto of Countess Maritza. And Julius Brammer was an actor, a former actor, and Alfred Grünewald was a very good writer, and they were quite young at that time. They had big successes before with Leo Fall, especially Die Rose von Stambul, The Rose of Stambul, was a huge success in 1916. But they tried to get in contact with Kálmán. And yeah, he let them wait for a long time. But the Countess Maritza, which was really made for him with its Hungarian flair, he couldn't resist anymore. And so they came together, and they became his closest collaborators during the 20s, until the Veilchen von Montmartre in 1930.
You mentioned that they had been trying to reach him for several years. Was it that he had rejected them? Was it that they were not well known? Tell us a little bit about that period.
Yeah, he was kind of suspicious. He had his first big success with Leo Stein and Bela Jenbach, with his Csárdásfürstin, Gipsy Princess. Mm-hmm. And of course, he didn't want to change his librettists. So that was the main thing. Why should he change a winning team? He thought he shouldn't write another Hungarian operetta so soon. So after Csárdásfürstin, he wrote Faschingsfee, which is located in Munich, then the Little Dutch Girl, which was located in the Netherlands. So he was a bit of, yeah, suspicious to repeat his success.
And then you mentioned Brammer and Grünewald became two of his successful collaborators after that. So what was it, the inevitable success of Countess Maritza that led them to collaborate, or did they develop a friendship, or how would you describe it?
Yeah, it was a kind of friendship which developed, but the whole time they didn't call each other with superstitious. That's the word. He was superstitious.
So after the superstition had recited, they became friends. And
The funny thing is, he believed that the 29th of February, in a, how do you say, in a this kind of year, every 4 years.
Yeah. Yeah, I know what you're I'm stumbling on too. Yeah.
That had a special meaning to him because his first symphonic composition was performed at that date and by case also Countess Maritza.
Yeah, we're referring to a leap year, by the way, for our listeners.
That was one point. And the other was, of course, the success they had. And yeah, the kind of relationship, it worked very well. And he felt comfortable with them. But he didn't offer them to say you. In Germany, you have the you and the C. Mm-hmm. Always called each other with a second name. And he said, oh, dear Mr. Grünwald and dear Mr. Kramer. And
so they didn't go beyond the deucing, in other words.
No, they didn't do that. The both librettists, they did. And they did also with Hubert Marischka, who was the hero of all those operettas they wrote together. And I think Hubert Marischka was the man who said, Kálmán, you have to collaborate with Kramer and Grünwald. He was also an important factor because he was the director, he was the hero. And for Kálmán, I think one important aspect was that when he took over Theater an der Wien, Leha left. Yeah. And Kálmán became the first composer of the Theater an der Wien. So that was a kind of triumph. So all those aspects fit together to make this winning team for the next, I think, only four operettas.
When we come back after the break, we will discuss Be Mine, My Love, Be Mine, another beloved tune from Countess Maritza.
Build the smartest nest from Debrecen to Budapest. Just wait until you build to Varasdin. My blood since I met you burns hotter than a goulash stew. My heart beats out a shardash, and what can this mean? Let's go to Varasdin, where I'm the king, you'll be the queen, and we shall paint the town red, white, and green.
We've heart so precarious, I fear you're gregarious, and fall for each pretty girl you meet.
You've no cause to doubt me, your life here without me is clearly forlorn and incomplete.
Your passion, poetic, though somewhat frenetic, at least yours are full of sip and zest. And what does it matter if your chatter's just flattery, for that makes a lady feel her best?
In that case, don't hesitate, you could wait till you're too late, why not put me through the test?
Let's go to Varasdin, the sweetest place you've ever seen. That's where our destiny has plans for you and me. We'll build the smartest nest from Debrecen to Budapest. Just wait until you've been to Varasdin. My blood since I met you I'm hotter than a goulash stew. My heart beats out a shudder, and what can this be?
Let's go to Varasdin, where I'm the king, I'll be the queen, and we shall paint the town red, white, and green.
Thank you.
Welcome back. I'm delighted to continue our conversation with Dr. Frey. Let's discuss Be Mine, My Love, Be Mine, another beloved tune from Countess Maritza. How does this tune compare and contrast to what we just heard? Let's go to Varasdin. And how do these two melodies fit into Kálmán's legacy almost 100 years after Countess Maritza premiered?
Komit na Varasdin is a comic song for the comic character. And so all the dance song, the modern dance songs are connected with the comic characters. And Be Mine, My Dear, Be Mine is, of course, very romantic for the leading couple composed. And it's, of course, a waltz song. And that's interesting that Kálmán is more famous for his Csárdás and Hungarian dances than for the waltz songs. But the waltz songs are very important in his work. Also in Csárdásfürstin, most songs are waltz songs. And of course, also in Maritza, the duets of the two leading characters are waltz songs. So in the second act, there are two big waltz songs, and one of them is Be Mine, My Dear, Be Mine. And the Kálmán waltz songs, they have always a kind of melancholic color. I think that makes Kálmán waltzes so special.
And how are they melancholic compared to, let's say, his rival, La Franz Lehár, which you alluded to earlier?
Yeah, Lehár also has very melancholic tunes, of course, but it's a different kind. For me, the Kálmán's character is always a bit of desperate.
And why do you think that is?
He doesn't believe in the luck he has now at the moment. He's always thinking, oh my God, I can lose it. And that's the thing I hear in his music.
So in other words, he's influenced by the zeitgeist and the kind of undercurrent of turmoil.
Yes, because the times are bad, but now we are happy, but who knows how long. So his waltzes became a bit over the top, accelerated. Let's be happy now.
And gypsy music is, of course, another prominent feature of Kálmán's music, including in Countess Maritza, where Play Gypsy is another beloved tune. Please tell us a little more about why gypsy music was so prominent in the world of operetta, and what was it that inspired Kálmán to incorporate into his music?
Gypsy music was very popular in this area because many gypsies lived there, of course, and many gypsy bands played in cafe houses and beer gardens. So it was quite common. And for a certain time, for example, Franz Liszt thought that the Hungarian music came from the gypsy music originally. Then later, Béla Bartók, who studied together with Kálmán in Budapest, he was looking for the original Hungarian music, which is very different from the gypsy music. But Kálmán felt very comfortable with the gypsy music. And his son told me, especially, it's not the Hungarian gypsy music, but the Romanian gypsy music, which influenced him most. And I think that's, you can see it in Maritza, because her name is Romanian, and she's coming from Bucharest, and the rival of the hero is also a Romanian nobleman. So this Romanian flavor is very specific for Kálmán's gypsy music.
And can you help us understand what the difference is between the Hungarian and Romanian rivalry, if you will, and how that plays out within this opera and within these characters and the different gypsy tunes?
Oh, in the gypsy tunes, I think the Hungarian gypsy music was more, how do you say, civilized, was already part of the high culture, became part of the high culture. You know, the Hungarian dances by Brahms and all the rhapsodies by Liszt, but the Romanian was more original gypsy. I think that's the difference. And in the play, of course, at the end, the Austrian character got the Romanian countess and not the Romanian character. So in the end of the play, the old Hungarian Austrian Empire wins, but musically, I think it's more the Romanian original gypsy music.
Thank you, Dr. Frey. If you like our podcast, please make sure to click like and subscribe.
I'll be there by 10 o'clock.